Thank you, Jeremy. There are two women pregnant at exactly the same time. They lovingly call their babies Munchkin and Bump. Both fetuses develop the sense of taste at exactly the same time. Munchkin's mother loves cooking apples. So Munchkin is used to the sour taste of cooking apples. Munchkin's mother decides to try some chocolate. Munchkin tastes the sweet and shudders. He doesn't like that sweet taste at all. He likes sour. Meanwhile, Bump's mother loves chocolate. So he's used to the taste of sweet. Bump's mother asks Munchkin's mother if she could have some of her cooking apple. She said, sure. So she tried some of the cooking apple. Bump shuddered at the taste of sour because he was used to the taste of sweet. Both women share a bowl of olives. Both Munchkin and Bump have a very different experience of the bitter, salty taste of the olives because of their experiences so far. This means really early on in our development, we are totally unique. The reality to these two little babies is completely different. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, oh no, Munchkin's going to have a life without chocolate. That is really bad. We really don't want a life without chocolate. Well, don't worry. It's not as bad as that. Because if you follow this train of thought, we think that some of our limitations are made before we are born. And to be quite frank, I think that's rather depressing. And it's not true. Nothing is set in stone ever. And it all starts in the womb. It all starts in the first trimester. Because the baby in the first trimester lays down taste buds where the tongue will grow. And the neurons connecting to those taste buds are already connecting. Then in the second trimester, the tongue grows and taste pores develop over the tongue. And now the taste is properly formed, so the baby can taste things through the amniotic sac, which is when the baby will get the first five basic flavours. The first five basic flavours are sweet and salty, bitter, sour, and umami, which the Japanese call that sort of pleasant, savoury taste. So all's good. So baby Munchkin has now got these basic tastes going on. But of course, the mother, experiencing all those foods for real, is experiencing a much bigger, much, much bigger flavour because she's using all her other senses. She's using the context which she's eating it. She's using the texture. She's using the smells. She's using the context of who she's eating with and what she's drinking with it. So all of a sudden, her palate becomes more sophisticated because she's taking in this other parts of the environment and the other senses are helping that. So there's help for Munchkin, because Munchkin's coming along now, Munchkin is born, and all the tastes in the menu that he likes and is exposed to from his parents in the school are actually expanding his limitless menu of what he wants to eat. In fact, he can eat tons of stuff, because it's not just a list, a menu of food, it's the ingredients within that. So in actual fact, the mathematical equation is really enormous. Now, let's think about this word menu to start with. Menu doesn't have to mean just food, does it? Because it is just a list. So it could mean the menu of one's life's experiences. It could mean where you choose to work. It could mean who you choose to help. It could mean lots of things. So the mathematical equation, again, is even bigger. The combination of all of these things is absolutely massive. Absolutely massive. So what is the key ingredient to all these menus that we have? What is the key ingredient to make it a limitless menu? The key ingredient, ladies and gentlemen, is curiosity. As simple as that. Just curiosity. Curiosity will save Munchkin from a life without chocolate. Because as soon as he is at school and meeting with new friends and they're eating chocolate, he's going to be curious and go, actually, I'd like some of that. Or maybe he's curious about the smell of the chocolate. Or maybe he's so curious that in actual fact he's not interested in the chocolate, he's going to be a connoisseur of olives for the bitter and sour taste. The point is, the menu is infinitesimal. And you know what else? The brain loves it. It loves this menu, this massive equation of all the things that we can try. It actually raises itself to gusto and really wants to embrace it all. And equally, our aging brain loves it even more because it helps our aging brain stay healthy. So curiosity is the main motivator for us to stay interested in things so that we become limitless. So what have we got? We've got a brain that is incredibly brilliant at neuroplasticity. We now know that we can, whatever we learn, whatever we're doing, whatever we're interacting with, will make sure our brain changes in anatomically as well as functionally. So all of a sudden we can give the big fat tick about the neuroplasticity of the brain. It's brilliant. We've got this wonderful menu of all the things, or menus of all these equations of things we can do in life to give our own individual menu of what we want to do, another big fat tick. So what is it when all of this thing is going right for us, we can do all these things we want to do, and we don't? What stops us? What actually stops us being curious? What actually stops us trying this stuff? Well, it might be because we grow up. It might be because we take on responsibilities. It might be that we take on the responsibility of rent, mortgage, bills, family, older parents, younger children. It might be that. But sometimes I think that, yes, those things do restrict us, but not as much as we like to think they do. Take, for instance, you've got some family member who's very unwell, and you're looking after them 24 hours a day. Now, that's restrictive, but that person will fall asleep. So you could, in actual fact, turn on your computer when they're asleep and enter a whole world of really wonderful things going on. You can learn anything. You can involve yourself in different kinds of social groups, all sorts of stuff, as long as you are curious. Always the key is curiosity. On the other end of the scale, you may find that, in actual fact, you have no responsibilities, that you're bored. Boredom is completely self-inflicted. I get really, really upset when I hear people say, I can't be bothered. In fact, if my kids said that to me, I went ballistic. Can't be bothered is apathy, and apathy is awful. It's a dreadful thing to do. So curiosity and wanting to find out about things is a massive motivator, and it also stimulates the reward systems in the brain. And by so doing, it also stimulates all those lovely feel-good neurotransmitters, which I'm sure you've heard of, dopamine and serotonin. Now, years ago, when my children were really, really little, I took them, it was a big family trauma going on, and I took them on this retreat for a weekend. We went on a Friday night, due to come home on a Sunday. And it was for yoga and meditation for adults and little people, which is fantastic. My kids went off in the morning, on the Saturday morning. They did these games and all sorts of things. One of the games was all the children had to sit in a circle, and each child took it in turns to be in the middle. And that child in the middle had a ball, and they threw it to each person in the circle around. Oh, that's handy, I'm on this. All around them as they're throwing a ball to each person. And the person who catches the ball has to say something nice about the person in the middle. Fantastic for self-esteem. The whole weekend was like that. So my children would come back to me in the breaks, go, oh, mummy, this is happening. Da, 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 da. And you know when children are really, really so excited they don't breathe? And all this was going on. And like, oh, whoa, I'm back in again. They're back in, they want more of it. I was utterly delighted, really delighted. Their curiosity was enormous. They'd embraced this whole new world. And the curiosity fed that interest, and the interest fed the curiosity. And it continued. So the children are always curious. They're curious because that's the key to their learning. That's why they're such sponges, or one of the reasons why they're such sponges for all sorts of information as they're growing. But at that same weekend, I learned something about my own curiosity. I actually went on this weekend with a friend, and whilst on the Sunday afternoon, I was packing up the car, ready to go home. It was dark, it was winter, and I was really, really keen to get the children home because they had school next day, and I had a three and a half hour drive at the other end, or to get there. My mate was decided, unbeknownst to me, to offer somebody else a lift. So I was packing the car, I got the children in the car, my friend was in the car, and this other girl was missing. She was taking ages and ages to come out after saying goodbye to all these people. I could feel all that wonderful work and all those benefits from the meditating and the yoga draining from my very body, because I've now got my hands on the steering wheel thinking, I've got to go, the traffic's building up, I've got to go, I've got to get the kids to bed, I've got this to do, I've got that to do, and my knuckles are getting whiter and whiter on the steering wheel. Finally, she appeared, and I'm like, I was really, really very stupid, but that's how I reacted. So I'm like, so I'm driving a car. This girl sat in the middle of the two children's seats, so I could see her in my rearview mirror, driving along. And they were talking, my friend and this girl in the back were talking, and I wasn't taking much notice because I was in too much of a foul mood by now. And all of a sudden, I heard this girl say that she was doing a PhD in social anthropology. I looked in the rearview mirror and I said, what actually is social anthropology? Well, she started to explain it. And the more she started to explain, the more questions I asked. I was firing at questions at her, firing and firing and firing. Because I can pinpoint the exact day when I first realized that my core of my very being was wanting to understand why people do what they do. And I was age 7. So I shot right back to then and I thought, this is what she's talking about. Social anthropology is all about people. It's about the difference between not having water in one of the tribes in South Africa to what happens when Tesco's comes to Chelmsford. It's about absolutely everything. It's a brilliant, brilliant topic. I was so fired up that I got home, put the children to bed, and I was completely doing loads and loads of searches about social anthropology and how I could study it. Because I had small children, I had to think about a university that was local to where I lived. So I found a university that did social anthropology and I had to choose it with another subject. So I chose it with psychology. It was a 4-year course, full time. Within about the fourth year, I realised actually social anthropology was so hard and actually psychology was easier for me in particular. So then I went on to do a master's in psychology and then I did a doctorate in neuroscience. The point is, had I have not been curious in my car at that moment, I would not be standing on this red dot now. I wouldn't have been because I wouldn't have gone to university as a mature student to start with. The whole world opened up as soon as I exercised my curiosity completely. And then my menu grew and expanded beyond anything I could ever imagine. So ladies and gentlemen, my biggest challenge really to say is this. Please stay curious, because what there is at the end of it is infinitesimal. Thank you very much.